Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, dear researchers, it's my great pleasure to welcome you for this second lecture taking place in our lecture series on sovereign debt, which is organized in collaboration with the Fonds National de la Recherche that I thank again for its support. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome here two distinguished lecturers. First of all, Rob Howse, who has been a friend for years, and I'm very proud of this. He's professor at NYU. You have his bio in the booklet of the lecture series, so I will not expand on this. Just to underline that among the many competences that he has in many fields, he has also this one about sovereign debt, about which he has worked notably for UNCTAD. And to comment and discuss his lecture, I'm very happy to welcome Matthias Goldmann, that I've also known for years now, although he's so young, and he's now professor at the University of Frankfurt, and he's also specialized in financial law and know very well about sovereign debt, so we can expect a very lively lecture. Before giving them the floor, I just recall that they are going to speak today about sovereign debt restructuring and international law. And I would like to thank for the organization of the lecture, of course, the staff of the Institute and Sabrina and Martina and the people who helped for preparing this this lecture. Also, of course, Alain et Enoch, the pair of researchers who have set up this lecture series. And I would like to offer a special mention to Enoch because I would like to wish him a happy birthday.
So thanks very much to my friend and colleague, Professor Louise Fabry, for this invitation. It's a pleasure to be back at Max Planck, Luxembourg. Today, I think I'm going to assume that most of you are not specialists in the area of sovereign debt or international financial law. So I'm going to take the first 10 minutes or so to talk generally about the nature of sovereign debt, the nature of sovereign debt crises, and what restructuring of sovereign debt actually means, both in financial and legal terms. And from there, we'll go on to consider how international law may be evolving with respect to the normative framework that governs sovereign debt crises and sovereign debt restructuring. So sovereign debt crises have been with us since really the 70s and 1980s. They usually happen when a state gets into a position where it is unable to continue to pay its debt service obligations in a manner that is consistent with its basic social, political, economic functions, which include operating public services, defense, and so forth. And this situation can occur for any number of reasons. Some of them have been macroeconomic changes in exchange rates where sovereign debt is denominated in foreign currencies, domestic or global recessions, downturns in demand that significantly affect tax revenues, investments of the state at a very major level that don't work out. So there can be any number of causes that can produce this situation where continued repayment on the original terms of the debt contract produce the level of social, political, economic crisis that leads a state to the point at which it either defaults or threatens to default. And we can get in, if you want to some of the technical meaning of default, but default essentially means that the state ceases to pay its full debt obligations and declares itself unable to do so, you know, on any basis that's consistent with its performing its basic functions and obligations to its own people as a sovereign state. So as we all know, and as economists such as Joe Stiglitz always remind us when they introduce this topic, when this happens to a private corporation, typically there is a legal framework of bankruptcy or insolvency law that kicks in, which allows the orderly restructuring of the debt, which in many jurisdictions also offers the possibility of the debtor getting a fresh start, where they can gain new access again to capital markets. So the difference with sovereign debt is that no such bankruptcy framework actually exists. So when the first sovereign debt crises led to defaults in the 80s, late 70s, 80s, for example, an informal framework had to evolved to address the situation of non-payment or threatened non-payment characterized as sovereign default. And so a diffuse and rather secretive or, you know, non-transparent set of institutions developed, the so-called London and Paris clubs. I think until recently, if you Googled Paris Club, basically what would come up was some strip joint in Vegas. That's how transparent the real Paris Club was. And also the International Monetary Fund. If you look at the fund's articles of agreement, you'll see nothing that would suggest that it has an authoritative role in the workout of sovereign debt. And yet, you know, these various institutions either morphed or emerged in order to deal with this problem. And the way they dealt with it was based upon what I will call the traditional Grund norm, which was the idea, contrary to what exists with almost any bankruptcy code in any sophisticated national economy, is that regardless of how unsustainable the debt is, and regardless of real economic conditions and its real market value given those conditions, a sovereign is obliged to repay the debt fully. There can be no debt forgiveness, there can be no debt relief. And, you know, here, just as it's often the last resort of scoundrels, international law was invoked for the so-called principle of the maintenance of obligations, that somehow a sovereign is absolutely bound, no matter what, to fully discharge its debt obligations. This notion of maintenance of obligations is probably based upon a fundamental conceptual confusion between contractual obligations, which most sovereign debt obligations are, and the principle of pacta sunt servanda, which applies not to contracts, but to treaties between states. In any case, that was the Grund norm. So what happened, and I got involved in this at a quite young age when I was representing Canada abroad. I was posted to Yugoslavia, and the Canadian Export Development Corporation had some exposure in the Yugoslav debt crisis. So what happened was something would occur called rescheduling. And what rescheduling would involve would be dragging out the repayment of the full principal and interest, and then charging the debtor country interest on that, and law firms and banks would receive high fees in order to do the rescheduling. In other words, instead of relief for the debtor country, these institutions would exploit the debtor country even more and make higher profits out of it, all based upon this idea that one can only postpone payment, which of course makes it the whole repayment more expensive, but one cannot actually provide debt relief. The IMF would come in and, as a kind of disciplinarian. It would offer something called a standby credit, but that would be conditional on a memorandum where the debtor country would be required to do things that IMF economists would believe would actually bring it back to a situation of solvency or economic health. Usually, these recommendations turned out to be absurd, perverse, and just something in the imagination of Ivy League educated economists that had little to do with the realities in those countries. So that's kind of how the system worked, and it dragged on and on. It became obvious in the case of some very poor countries that they couldn't pay back their loans. So eventually, some kind of debt relief was constructed with the World Bank and the Fund for the poorest indebted countries, just a kind of reality check that they were never going to repay this this money. There are two kinds of debt. Official debt is the debt that sovereign debtors owe to other governments. That's basically handled in the Paris Club. That's the one that I was working with at the time, not the Paris Club in Las Vegas, but the one that dealt with the debt rescheduling. And London Club with respect to the debt that sovereigns owe private creditors. So, you know, also there were attempts to disguise debt relief through a variety of techniques called debt equity swaps, even debt nature swaps, where, you know, debt was reduced in return for some kind of environmental project being undertaken by the debtor country. But and a secondary market developed as well, where in some cases states could get debt relief in a surreptitious way by buying their own debt back on the secondary market, where it was actually priced to reflect its real value given changed economic circumstances. So, and then there were things called Brady bonds, and I won't go into all of these various tricks that were used in order to address the discordance between basic economic reality, which is that the debt was worthless, and ultimately there had to be a solution to work that out, just as you have to have that solution in a private bankruptcy, where with respect to the assets of, you know, a private company, until a major game-changing event occurred. And this was Argentina's decision to tell the IMF where to get off and to move towards basically a restructuring that involves significant debt relief. The expression for that is haircut. To negotiate with its creditors under the threat that if they did not accept a significant haircut, Argentina would unilaterally reduce the repayments to reflect what would be required for the sustainability of its economy. So a very large percentage of the creditors actually participated in the negotiations and swapped out instruments that basically resulted in a haircut of about 75%, 25 cents on the dollar, more or less. There were holdouts, and then there were vultures, vulture funds, and we'll get to them in a second. But this was a game changer, because what Argentina was saying is that basically there's no meta norm, there's no grund norm that prevents us from basically saying the current level of debt repayment is unsustainable for our country. We can't get economic growth going again. We can't take care of our people unless we cut the debt, and we're going to do it. And so initially, of course, the United States Treasury was very upset. Initially, the fund, the IMF, was very upset. But they realized there wasn't a lot that could be done about it. So in one fell swoop, Argentina gave the powerful example that actually it would be possible for a country to use its sovereign power to just say unilaterally, we need a workout of our debt. And if you aren't going to give it to us through negotiation, we will take it through imposing it through our own legal system. So that was a big step forward. And I think it really changed in many ways the game, because no longer could one say that there's this unbreakable norm of full repayment no matter what, no matter how desperate your people are, no matter how in bad shape your economy is. Now, after that, we all know what happened, which is a judge in New York basically allowed vulture funds to collect the full amount of the debt that they had bought from holdouts on the secondary market at a great discount. By full amount, I mean the face value of the initial obligations before the restructuring. Now, that's not in itself something that's necessarily that controversial. The judge just enforced the contract of the holdouts, and there was no collective action clause it's very complicated, but let's put it this way, that there was not an adequate provision in these particular bond contracts that would allow legally the support of a large majority of creditors to defeat the holdout, such that the holdout, the obligation to the holdout, would then just become the obligation on the restructured terms agreed with 70-80% of all of the creditors. So these particular instruments didn't have that, and they had the unfortunate feature that New York was the applicable forum. And so, okay, the judge enforces it, but what he does, which is kind of insane, is that he says, I'm going to enforce it by stopping repayment to the restructured creditors. So I'm going to try and undermine Argentina's entire restructuring, because what I'm going to do, is to make an order that would hold in contempt of the New York court any financial institution that would facilitate the ongoing payments to the restructured creditors. And given the nature of the international activities of most financial institutions, they have good reasons not to want to be held in contempt of the New York court. So before the new right-wing government came into power in Argentina, the Kirchner government was looking at other options to pay the restructured creditors, swapping out with obligations under Argentine law in pesos, or maybe using China or some financial intermediary that was not vulnerable to being held in contempt of court in New York. And then, of course, the new government decided just to pay off the vultures to send a positive signal to, or what it thought would be a positive signal to the market. So we would never know how it would have turned out if Argentina, as I would have hoped they would have done, would have continued to resist paying out the vulture funds. But the question is, where do we stand today in terms of international legal normativity? Now, does the ability of Elliott Capital to get this sweeping order from the New York court represent a reversion to a normative baseline that suggests that restructuring is unacceptable and that a sovereign is expected to fully repay all of its debt? I don't think so. And I'm going to look at a variety of developments that have happened in the last year or two that suggest that we actually are moving towards, or back to at least, the norm that a sovereign should have the right to engage in a restructuring exercise, even if this involves haircuts to creditors, where to do so is necessary in order to resolve a serious social and economic crisis. Now, I'm not going to talk about the sources of international law much, soft law versus hard law, but I think that you'll see that the various developments that I'm going to talk about do seem at least to be international practice of a sort that does suggest a shift to a right to a restructuring. I'm not going to talk very much about some of the exercises that Matthias and I have been involved in, the UNCTAD roadmap, which fed into the UN resolution of principles for sovereign debt restructuring. Those explicitly refer to a right to restructure and some principles to govern the exercise of that right, but rather to diverse decisions of different courts and tribunals that I think are very interesting from this point of view. So one avenue that seemed to be open to holdouts and, just a second, open the computer again, and vultures, was the possibility, if you weren't able to sue an investor and find a judge as kind of dotty as Judge Grisa, was to use investor state dispute settlement to do it. And that's what bondholders did in the Abaclot case. They sued Argentina in ICSID. And it was held in that case that these sovereign bonds were an investment within the meaning of the bilateral investment treaty and the ICSID convention, with a very powerful dissent by a great international jurist and human rights lawyer, Georges Abissab. Just a second, I'm trying to get this open. I think this is going to do it. Yep, great. In a subsequent case and in other international practice, we have seen gradually the door being shut to this notion that investor state arbitration can be used to try and dismantle or disrupt a sovereign debt restructuring. The most important case is Poshaba Banka versus Greece. And in that case, there was a very broad definition of investment in the treaty, which included in the illustrative list of covered investments a loan or any claim, a contractual claim for money. So you would think that a sovereign bond contract or debt contract would fall into that. But the tribunal engaged in a very interesting analysis. And in that analysis, it said that sovereign debt has certain features that should make one not lightly assume that it is going to be included in any particular terminology that describes an investment, like a loan or claim for money. And I'm just going to read to you from the decision, because I think these words are very important in terms of where we're going, and they're from an international tribunal, after all, in terms of international legal baselines in this area. The tribunal said, sovereign debt has special features and characteristics. First, it is clearly a method of financing government operations from investments in infrastructure to ordinary government expenditures. Second, it is a key instrument of monetary and economic policy. Third, sovereign debt is subject to a high degree of political influence and risk. A sovereign state engages in complex decisions, both in negotiating and structuring in the debt, and repayment is subject not only to the normal credit risk of any credit operation, but also political decisions that are extremely sensitive for the inhabitants of the given state. And so the tribunal is almost saying that when you buy sovereign debt, it's almost an implicit term that because of the political implications of sovereign indebtedness, you may be subject to some kind of restructuring. And so the tribunal then goes on to say, fourth, while ordinary credits generally embody the interest of the main parties to the credit agreement and the influence of third parties is limited, sovereign debt is highly influenced in different degrees by both internal and external factors. In other words, there are affected third parties, and that's something that has to be taken into account. You can't view this as just a normal enforcement of a contract. Finally, sovereign debt, they say, is an instrument of government monetary and economic policy, and its impact at local and international levels makes it an important tool for handling social and economic policies of the state. The ultimate result of this is that unless there are clear textual indications in a treaty, the presumption will be that sovereign debt is not included as an investment. And I think that's a very, very important decision. And it's been picked up in a way, if I can put it so crudely, or at least it's been amplified in the text of the recent texts of new trade agreements, like the CETA, the fate of which, the Canada-EU agreement, the fate of which we will know maybe in 15 minutes from now, whether there's been an agreement with Belgium to get it to go forward, which exclude in many ways the possibility of creditors, including vultures, using investor-state arbitration to disrupt debt restructurings. There's weaker language, but still language to the same effect in the legal text of the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So we are starting to use, through international law, international tribunals, we are starting to close the door if not entirely, to this kind of strategy of disrupting debt restructurings through investor-state arbitration. I'd also like to, point to some litigation that's happened within Europe, which relates to the Greek debt crisis. In the Mamatis case, bondholders sued Greece in the private bondholders in the European Court of Human Rights, claiming that they were improperly expropriated by the haircut that Greece gave to private bondholders. They also claimed they were discriminated against because they were, not major institutions with which Greece had directly negotiated, but individuals, natural persons, who were in less of a position to bear a haircut. So they claimed discrimination on the grounds that they weren't given special treatment. Well, what did the court say? It basically said that whatever right to property these claimants might have is subject to the broad authority of the state, to which the court will be largely deferential to manage political, economic, and social questions. The extent of the deference is reflected in the following passage, which I'm translating from the French original. The court considers that national authorities find themselves in principle better placed than an international tribunal to choose the most appropriate means achieve these ends of social, economic, political stability, and the court will respect their choices unless these are manifestly shown to be lacking in a reasonable basis. So extremely deferential standard. A debt restructuring only has to have a reasonable basis to defeat the property or contractual rights of the debt holders. The court went on to find that, you know, in fact, one of the principles that it was reasonable for Greece to follow was equity among creditors, and if it started to give special dispensations based upon individual considerations to different creditors, this might undermine the whole basis for a restructuring. Finally, and this relates to, you know, the UN principles, which emphasize equity, transparency, and so on, the court found it important that the haircuts were done through legislation, through a formal and open legal structure that involved parliamentary deliberation and the chance for stakeholders to take explicit positions on the issue and persuade the political authorities of their point of view. So it's in accord with the rule of law, in accord with the norm of publicity. Now, in another case, in the European Court of Justice, Accortini and European Central Bank, there, this also concerned Greece, creditors sued based on the, again, a discrimination theory that the European Central Bank was treating, that the European institutions were getting a better deal than private creditors who had to take a haircut. And the basic analysis of the court was that, you know, that was there was a rational distinction because the institutions were involved for public purposes, not for purposes of private advantage or profit. We can talk a bit about how justifiable that reasoning was, but there's other reasoning in this decision that I think, again, is extremely important in understanding the extent to which we may be moving to some kind of international community norm of a right to restructuring. And so I'm going to read from paragraph 82, again, translating from the French. The purchase by an investor, you know, of sovereign debt instruments constitutes, by definition, a transaction that entails a certain financial risk because they are dependent upon the direction of capital markets. And, you know, and in this case, some of the creditors acquired, and this, you know, is very much a kind of what vultures do, they acquired the instruments during a period of financial crisis. And basically what the court says is that if investors buy these instruments, and especially if they're aware of the existence or maybe even the possibility of a financial crisis, they could be understood to be accepting the risk of the possibility that the sovereign state will have to restructure the debt and that they will be subject to a haircut. Again, as with Poshtva Banka, there's, I think, the fairly strong notion that you know, the possibility and permissibility of restructuring may almost be an implicit term of a sovereign debt contract, and again, this would not necessarily change the situation under U.S. law with Judge Grisa, but it does, I think, reflect you know, an evolution of international policy of great importance, starting with, again, the original decision of Argentina to restructure and in effect be willing to impose, if necessary, unilaterally haircuts on its creditors. I'd like to talk just about two other developments that I think also move in the direction of trying to prevent the disruption of restructurings by, for example, vulture funds. One is the Belgian anti-vulture funds law, and it goes quite far to prohibiting the enforcement of sovereign debt obligations in Belgium, or the attempt to, you know, execute against assets in Belgium under a number of circumstances. These include the following, and again, you know, we can talk about how closely parallel these are to, you know, the international soft law that has evolved through the UNCTAD principles for responsible lending and borrowing, and now the UN resolution of principles on sovereign debt restructuring. So some of the circumstances are, well, first of all, the fund has to have purchased the state debt at a price manifestly disproportionate with either its face value or the amount that it seeks to be repaid. That's sort of like the definition of what a vulture is. And at least one of the following special circumstances is present. The state was in or very close to a situation of succession of payments, i.e. default, when the debt was purchased, or the fund is incorporated in a blacklisted tax haven jurisdiction. The fund systematically institutes court proceedings to obtain payment. The state did restructure its debt, but the fund refused to participate in the restructuring. The fund abused the weaknesses of the state. The full repayment of the claimed amount would have a clear adverse impact on the budget of the state and would be likely to compromise the social economic development of its population, which I think definitely goes to one of the principles in the UN resolution, which refers to the sustainability of debt in terms of, you know, the socioeconomic situation of the state and its citizens. So this law has been passed. It's now being challenged by vultures. As far as I know, still the court case is still going ahead before the Belgian Constitutional Court. And when that decision comes out, I think we'll have another data point in how, you know, what I would describe as international policy or the international normative framework is evolving with respect to sovereign debt restructuring. Finally, what about another dimension of this whole problem, which I alluded to earlier in mentioning IMF memoranda, which is the imposition of conditions for bailouts, which are often just another way of thinking about what I called earlier rescheduling, to the extent that they don't involve any real debt relief. So, notoriously, the European institutions, egged on by torturer-in-chief Schäuble, have been punishing Greece by imposing a set of irrational and draconian domestic public policy choices as a condition, a debt bailout, a bailout or workout, which hasn't until recently involved even promises of real debt relief, and Schäuble is still resisting any kind of haircut. So, what about the impact on human rights of some of the things that Greece is being required to do? An interesting innovation was made by Greece's labor minister, who was involved in the appointment of an independent committee of experts to analyze, for example, the kinds of damage that the institutions had been attempting to inflict on rights of collective bargaining and other labor rights in Greece. And so I think it's a very smart idea. Get independent international experts from different countries, including labor economists, and ask them, you know, how does this stand up, what the European institutions are asking, against proper norms of labor law? And so if you look at what this independent committee regarded as the normative benchmarks, not surprisingly, it referred to ILO law, it referred to, the European Social Charter as the appropriate benchmarks to analyze the legitimacy and propriety of what the European institutions were doing or trying to do to Greece. And again, it's a way of bringing the order from international law into this whole process of sovereign debt restructuring. Now, this committee doesn't have any power in and of itself, but it has a kind of a legitimacy that will allow Greece to fight back, and is allowing Greece now to fight back with the institutions, and not simply be seen as recalcitrant to make reforms that are appropriate or efficient or whatever terminology the neoliberals might wish to use, because Greece is not resisting, or Syriza is not resisting out of some commitment to Marxist or far left ideology, but resisting on the basis of a balanced group of experts' opinion that this simply is contrary to the basic benchmarks that underlie the whole approach to labor and social protection in the European political and economic space. So what we have here is obviously something very different from what some of my colleagues would imagine international law would contribute to sovereign debt restructuring, which is some kind of world sovereign bankruptcy court, what is often referred to in these debates as a statutory rather than contractual approach, where you have a multilateral institution and multilateral hard law framework, which is the obligatory framework for debt restructuring. So we're not moving in that direction, and we're not at least anytime soon or anytime fast, although some version of that might be implied from some of the language in the UN resolution. But I think what we are doing is we're moving through some evolution of international law, and if I had more time, I'd talk also a bit about sovereign immunity, to an approach that is underpinned instead of by the notion that a sovereign has to always repay no matter what, by the idea that a sovereign facing a social and economic crisis has a presumed right to engage in debt restructuring, including haircuts, and that when creditors buy these obligations, they implicitly accept the risk that the social and political sensitivity that is entailed in sovereign debt management will lead to a restructuring that will include taking some kind of reduction in what they are owed. And that in itself, to my mind, is an enormous, enormous progress from the world that I was introduced to in my early 20s.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to act here as a commentator after this instructive, impressive lecture by my former teacher, Rob Howse. I would like to thank Hélène very much for the invitation, and those who helped her in the organization, Enoch and Ella. When I was preparing for this, and when we met earlier here, we had discussed that it might be difficult to enter in something like an academic mud fight tonight. Because, not just because we are very civilized people, but also because we might not disagree terribly on fundamental issues if it comes to sovereign debt restructuring. Both of us have worked on these issues for together.
It's not going to be a Trump-Clinton debate.
No, it's not going to be a Trump-Clinton debate. Nevertheless, in academia, sometimes we don't like these debates. We rather like to carve out the small nuances. And after hearing, after listening to your talk, I think that there are a couple of small nuances which I can carve out and on which we might disagree or not. We'll see to what extent we disagree on that. Now, if I'm taking this, sorry, my technical, yeah. What I would like to do in the next couple of minutes is to take you on a road and consider a little bit the broader picture, because on, one of the points on which I disagree is whether there we are faced here with a situation of strong disruptions, or, and especially whether the case of Argentina is really that much of a turning point in the history of sovereign debt restructuring. Rather, what I would like to say in the first part of my talk is that the move from private to public is much more a case of continuity than of disruptions. And I would like to go through several stages with you. Then the second point I want to make is that we should not mix up a development in the mechanisms of sovereign debt restructuring with questions of solidarity, so with the how. So we should not mix up the whether with the how. And in the third part, some consequences of that for international arbitration and dispute settlement. Now let me go to that. What am I talking here about when I say that there is a move from the private to the public in the course of, let's say, the last 100 years of the history of sovereign debt restructuring? Well, I'm appealing here, or I'm referring here to the principles which we can extract from the practice. So how can you imagine that? Now the question is, can we really measure, how can we measure practice? Can we measure practice by some standards? Yeah. If we want to have some standards, where do these standards come from? Do they come from philosophy, from heaven, from hell, from somewhere? I think the best way to develop standards for measuring practice is to look at practice itself and carve out the major traits of practice. And that looks like this. So this is a painting by Pollock. And if you look at it, in the first moment, at first sight, you will see a chaos. But then if you look at it a bit more carefully, you will see the major trait. You will see a structure, yeah? You will see that there's, for example, here, no, I can't make this work. Anyway, here on the top left, you will see there's something like a center. It's very bright. Further below, there's another center more in, towards the middle. Here again, there's another center where you have a lot of white and blue and so on, and where the brushes are a bit broader. And so that is how you carve out principles of practice, the major traits. And that's what I want to do for sovereign debt restructuring. Now, four stages. Let's consider the long 19th century first. It was characterized by private lending and by bonds, for the most part, which were restructured in a bilateral relationship, so in a purely contractual fashion. You had some multilateralization, some bondholder committees, or the British Corporation of Foreign Bondholders, and later on an American equivalent, where bondholders met, but the point was that debtors and their creditors restructured in a purely bilateral fashion. There was nothing like any public interest in sovereign debt sustainability. Yeah? And that lasted until about the First World War. Now, in the interwar period, things changed a little bit. And of course, they changed for a reason. There was a lot of war debt. And now what you had at that point were restructurings that were that took place at the government level. So you had things like, for example, the Dawes plan or the Young plan that restructured German debt in that case. And that still happened very much under a contractual paradigm. So it was like a doed debt. It was not really about re-establishing debt sustainability. It was about securing repayment. And in that respect, I really agree with Rob. But we should take notice of a very important development at that time going on in the League of Nations. So the League of Nations, through its fiscal committee, developed a practice of recommending best policies to states in order to lend them some credibility. So if states followed the policy advice of the League of Nations Fiscal Committee, they were able to regain market access. The League didn't lend itself, unlike the IMF, important difference. Maybe that gave the League a particular kind of credibility. So you had the emergence of debt sustainability, the emergence, just the emergence of debt sustainability as a global concern. It was somehow considered as important for also peace and security, the goals of the League. Now, after World War II, that somehow continued seamlessly with the institutions that Rob mentioned, like the Paris Club and the London Club. Lending practice changed. You had more official lending at that period, syndicated loans for emerging country, just official debt for a developing country. And restructuring still had the goal of recovery, not really of debt relief. So nevertheless, what we need to face is the fact that restructuring became a routine in that respect. So you had a steady institution with the Paris Club, at least a place where creditors could go and get a more and more regularized procedure. So the Paris Club has a lot of soft law in its internal workings, which set out the procedure and the terms under which it is willing to restructure. So, and in the last stage, which I think begins already sometime in the 1980s, you really see a change that is of a fundamental nature, because now recovery is not the only goal anymore. Now, I have a long list of initiatives and of events here, and I cannot go through all of them, so that and Rob has mentioned some of them. So we have Brady bonds, we have IMF lending into arrears, so even if you have arrears to your private creditors, you can still get access to the IMF. You have the Paris Club, which starts to grant debt relief with the Naples terms. We have got the HIPC initiative, heavily indebted poor countries initiative, around the turn of the millennium, continued by the multilateral debt restructuring initiative. And of course, in the during the global financial crisis, you had similar developments. And what comes here also is human rights. So human rights for the first time are brought in or are mentioned in a sovereign debt context. So I really think at that point you can say that the goal of debt restructuring is not recovery anymore, but it's the financial health of the debtor country that becomes so fundamental. And of course, it was all the crisis that we've experienced in the last 30 years or so, which made that development take place. And that's somehow my hunch. I think Argentina is really crucial for many of the initiatives that we experienced through the last couple of years. The Eurozone debt crisis, I think, is also an important factor for that. But so policy-wise, it might be important, but it actually only brings to the culmination a development which is a bit longer in my view. Now, the important second point that I want to make is that this whole mechanism that I just set out, it's about the if question, so to say. So, are you allowed to restructure, so to say? And is there a mechanism to which you can turn in case of a debt crisis? It does not say anything about the particular policies that lead to the restructuring. What we see here is a great incoherence, and also over time. You have got some instances where a lot of solidarity was exercised, and others where there was very little solidarity. So a lot of very little solidarity, for example, we had after the First World War. I think I don't need to go there. There was very little debt relief, and Germany would have had to pay back until, I think, 1987, of which they paid very little, but so there was no debt relief. Unlike after the First World War, things were quite different after the Second World War. So the London Debt Agreement provided for quite some generous relief. Germany's pre-war debt was relieved by, I think, about 50% effectively. So not in nominal terms, but in real terms. And there was standstill for Germany's reparations, so they didn't have to pay back reparations. All that Germany paid were compensations for victims of atrocities. Yeah, that didn't really happen under that strict conditionalities, but what happened rather was that this opened the gate for the economic integration of Germany, the economic, political, and military integration of Germany in the Western world. Yeah, of course, it's a Cold War background, and there was a Marshall Plan. There were investments. This is completely different, or has been completely different in 2015 in the case of Greece. So Rob has said everything that needs to be said there. We don't have debt relief. We have quite demanding policy conditionalities, which haven't worked for about 5 years, and they're unlikely to work. So you see that the question of solidarity is a different one from the question whether there should be an institutional framework, so to say, to which you can turn, where you have a regularized debt relief and which is there to somehow bring you back on track. But we disagree on how to bring a country back on track. Now, that's basically here in these last two lines. Now, what are the consequences of all these principles, of this principle of sovereign debt sustainability and this move to a public concern? I think there are consequences for jurisdiction and for legal defenses, and I guess that I might disagree with Rob on jurisdictional issues. I think if we consider that debt restructuring is a public concern and that a lot of international organizations, states, quasi-international organizations, supranational organizations are engaging in debt relief, it is almost indispensable that we have some profound legal review of what they do. Maybe that just shows that I'm very German, because Germans think that the law is really something that can regulate the economy. This has a little bit to do with order liberalism, but it also has a lot to do with the 19th century and legal history and you know, the late emergence of democracy. So if you don't have democracy, what you have is the law. So we really believe in legal review. And so I also believe in legal review of some debt restructuring. That is why I would respectfully disagree on the wisdom of the Potsdamer Banka judgment. Now, I find it very, very good that they point out that there is a big difference between sovereign debt and normal private debt. Nevertheless, I would have been so much more happy to read that in the decision on the merits and not on jurisdiction. Why are states afraid of judicial control? Just put in place a good framework. Yeah, so that's my point. And in the interest of time, I don't want to discuss the other judgments, but Fahrenbrock and Itlos Ara Libertad case are good examples of how you can do it. Like in Ara Libertad, Itlos really tried to grab jurisdictions by all means, at all costs. I think it's judicially, doctrinally, very difficult to construe jurisdiction in that case. They really didn't have it because it didn't really concern the convention. It really it was a question of immunities, which are not regulated in the convention. Nevertheless, they said, we have jurisdiction here, we have to decide the case. Yeah. So that's what I want to say on jurisdiction. And the last point I want to make is on legal defenses. I think we also have to consider legal defenses that debtor states raise in these disputes in light of the principle that I just set out. So how about necessity? Is necessity good to reach debt sustainability? I don't think so, because necessity is really a contractual defense. Yeah, it gives you relief as long as you are in a crisis situation. It doesn't really lead to debt sustainability is not something that is in any way relevant to the question whether you can invoke necessity. Plus, there's the issue of responsibility. If you're responsible for your own mess, don't invoke necessity. So I think it's right that Argentina did not get very far with that, even though they don't like to hear it. Immunities, it's the same thing. Why are you afraid of jurisdiction? Just put in place a good framework, yeah? I must say, immunities, it's also mentioned in the UN basic principles. That's the only thing that you don't really find in UNCTAD's work. That's the major point of disagreement. What they put in there doesn't really add anything to the customary immunities. Nevertheless, I didn't really understand why they put it there. Yeah. Good faith is another possible defense that you might raise, which might have more success because we have a very strong idea about the duty to negotiate, and that's something that somehow relates to a good faith. And that is also well recognized in international law as the prohibition of the abuse of rights. Nevertheless, a problem is that good faith only exists in contractual relationships. So it's a bit difficult to multilateralize it. So for the private lawyers among you, they will know what that is. The second problem is that the German Bundesgerichtshof, Federal Court of Justice, just said in 2015 that they don't like good faith as a defense, but it has to be said that they didn't really scrutinize it. They just referred to a 2007 judgment of the Constitutional Court, where the Constitutional Court said, well, necessity doesn't give you a defense. So they kind of mixed up necessity and good faith. Now, the ultimate defense that I think is, at least for the future, I think to reckon with is human rights. Human rights have been used in the recent disputes as a means to question particular austerity measures or particular structural reforms. That's all fine. It didn't really get that far in most cases. In some cases, that was successful before national jurisdictions. Nevertheless, what I think is really the main point is to understand good human rights as a defense that somehow gives creditors a right to enter into negotiations in good faith and to fend off creditors' claims in order to reestablish their economic or their financial viability, which is a precondition for social and economic human rights. Yeah? So that's about it. I wanted to say some more words on the ECB, but I think maybe we can save that for discussion. With the question is to what extent the ECB stance is really in line with current principles of sovereign debt restructuring. Sorry for probably taking a bit too long. Here is a source where some of the thoughts that I just set out can be read. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much to you both. We have heard about many different topics in both the lecture and the comment, and about immunities and also human rights, notably. And Rob, you say that you postponed speaking about immunities, but as Matthias has touched upon the topic, maybe you would like to react on this.
Well, I would only say that, I mean, one of the, you know, the issues posed by the, you know, the judgment of in the Elliott Capital case in New York is whether, you know, an order that, you know, basically, you know, stops the payment of the restructured creditors, for example, and disrupts or facilitates the vulture disrupting a restructuring, or even in a way unwind it, a restructuring that's already occurred, is consistent with international legal norms concerning, you know, sovereign immunity. So there's no question that in most of these contracts, the debtor waives sovereign immunity, so that even if the forum of the contract of contractual enforcement doesn't have a commercial exception to sovereign immunity, you have a waiver. But the question is how far that waiver goes. Does it go just to the jurisdiction of the forum, or does it also go to immunity from seizure of state assets to enforce the contract? And arguably, it doesn't include a waiver of immunity with respect to state assets. So that would be determined by the sovereign immunity doctrine of each jurisdiction. But the International Court of Justice in the Germany v. Italy case has held that there is a core international law norm of sovereign immunity. Now, in that decision, unfortunately, the ICJ didn't give us much of an indication of what that core is. In other words, what kinds of specific exceptions from immunity that might be present in municipal law would be consistent with the customary international law obligation of sovereign immunity. So we don't have real guidance from the ICJ. We only know that there is such a norm, and if the ICJ is correct, that it's actually quite a foundational norm for the international legal system. Now, when we look at what GRISA does, is basically GRISA says that we will say that any financial institution is is risking being in contempt of our court, of the New York court, if it facilitates these payments to the restructured creditors. Now, my question would be, isn't that coming close to fundamentally eroding the core of sovereign immunity? Because the assets that Argentina was using to pay these creditors were assets even subject to the commercial exception for sovereign immunity. These were state assets being paid to third parties from the Argentina treasury. And the effect of Greece's order was, in a sense, to interfere with assets over which the New York court, I don't think rightly had any claim. Those were not assets to which those were assets to which the restructured creditors under law were entitled, and they were assets that Argentina, I would argue, was free to dispose of as it pleased. I don't think that they were commercial assets, but rather the funds in the public fisc that had been raised through taxation primarily.
Any reaction, Matthias? No, not specifically. I just want to raise a question. We have first question here and then.
Thank you, Philip Thomas. I'm here as the Honorary Consul of Fiji. The question is, what about the repudiation of odious debt, rather? Maybe that would be the first step for a country to invoke that the way the debt was contracted was improper, it was not covered by budgetary requirements. There is a recent case regarding Mozambique, I think, where all of a sudden 1.5 billion or so of unrecorded and improperly incurred debt have turned up. There could also be issues regarding the way that foreign investment bankers induced a country to incur debt. There was a recent case regarding Libya and its sovereign wealth fund, which, however, Libya lost. So this would be an additional area to consider. Then an annex question would be, is there a general trend in U.S. law, which is also reflected by the recent cases of the city of Detroit and perhaps the restructuring of General Motors, giving precedence to classes of debtors, trade unions, health insurance funds, whatever, that were not expected to be benefiting in that priority order? And perhaps a third aspect, which was never examined, whether the citizens of a particular nation might be directly liable for the debt incurred by that state. For instance, there could be Greek ship owners residing in London who are a lot wealthier than their own state. Similar things have happened regarding the confiscation of enemy assets during the world wars. So it wouldn't be totally unexpected for citizens to be made liable for the debts of their state. Thanks.
Well, I wrote a study for UNCTAD, and I think it was published maybe around 2007 on the doctrine of odious debt in public international law. To get my long answer, you should just Google the study. So the odious debt doctrine, I would say, emerges as a response to the notion that I was talking about earlier of maintenance of obligations, that that there might be some circumstances where, you know, the meta norm of full repayment shouldn't apply because of the circumstances under which the debt was contracted. And the original version of the doctrine, as developed by Sack, has two prongs, that the debt is contracted by an odious regime and for an odious purpose. Now, recent concerns about illegal debt, and the investigation into the odiousness of Greek debt that that was started by the Greek Parliament but then stopped, those are situations that don't meet the criteria of an odious regime generally. There might have been corruption of state officials or irresponsibility of state officials, but it's not, I think, the situation that Sack had in mind. This being said, I think these are important and weighty arguments. I have suggested to people in the Greek government that they should consider, you know, suing Goldman Sachs, actually. But so far, I don't seem to have whipped up a lot of enthusiasm for doing that. But there are definitely, if you investigate very closely, you know, if you look at the IMF's own internal investigation of its role in Greece, and you'll see that the IMF's internal watchdog was not able to get a certain amount of the information about the deals that were being done between Strauss-Kahn and the Europeans and the machinations to kind of hijack the IMF in order to save the German banks, which is, you know, basically what happened. I think there's a big story there, but you would need discovery to get that. And the fund couldn't even get those blackberries of Strauss-Kahn or whatever. At least it's too bad there was an opportunity when he left one in a hotel room in New York, but that had a certain different set of consequences. And then there's the question of whether one could sue in their personal capacities officials who might have been involved in some, you know, kind of essentially racketeering surrounding the way in which the Greek government ended up on the hook because of bad loans that were made by German and other non-Greek European institutions. I think the way the doctrine is emerging is that once officials are no longer serving, they don't any longer really have full immunity from suit. And if they were acting with impropriety, in other words, outside of their formal mandate, and arguably there was no formal mandate to do what Strauss-Kahn did with Greece, there was no formal mandate in the IMF. So there are a lot of interesting possibilities for, you know, aggressive and imaginative litigation strategies, and I fully endorse exploring all of those. On the question of whether citizens could be legally liable for the debt of the state in some way, I mean, I think you would have to have some specific causal connection. So, you know, if the imprudent advice was given, or, you know, or there were some corruption or fraud involved in a private bank or consulting firm, for example, advising the government concerning the undertaking of the debt obligations or their restructuring, and it turned out badly, then it might be, there could be a theory that you could construct that private actor has some responsibility. But I think it would be very circumstance specific. The idea that people in general in a society are individually responsible for government debt doesn't seem to make much sense in light of the contractual constructions. Now, where individuals might be liable is indeed in a situation where, you know, the debt is connected to, you know, to international crimes for which there's now, as we know, individual liability. But except in a circumstance of individual crime where, you know, there's some kind of actual complicity of individuals, I just don't see this, you know, the logic of individual responsibility. But if you play out for me a bit the legal argument that you're thinking of, perhaps we could have an exchange about it.
Can I say a small thing on the last, make a small remark on the last question, suing citizens directly for the liabilities of their state? I hope that this will never be the case for a very important reason. If you let, I mean, we are all aware that there are some people from poor states who are conspicuously rich. Nevertheless, if you let it happen that they be sued for debts of the state, it would mean that you openly admit and even strengthen the notion that they own the state. And it's a privatization which is somehow driven or taken to an extreme level. What you rather have to do to enable the state to regain and recover the funds, so to say. And I think the way to go about that is international tax law. And that is what has been recognized in the course of the last years, that the sovereign debt crisis is also to some extent the symbol or the upshot of a crisis or of the absence of an appropriate international system for taxation. I think the Panama Papers have revealed everything that needs to be said in that respect, and that doesn't just concern companies, but it also concerns the possibility of private citizens to hide funds and funds which they got in problematic ways. But I think it is for the states to recover these funds, and they would be strengthened by that, and their position as officials would be, so to say, reaffirmed. And then we can talk about debt restructurings.
But I mean, here we may actually be getting to some disagreement. I mean, I briefly did some work in the Philippines concerning the Marcos debt. I mean, you wouldn't say that until there's an international taxation system, you would have a problem with suing the Marcos family to get the money back.
If the Philippines sued the Marcos family, I wouldn't have a problem with the Philippines suing them. I would have a problem with third parties suing them. I think because, you know, the important thing
even
is that there
is... Even if they basically stole the funds.
It is for the Philippines to sue them. If they stole the funds, then the Philippines are entitled to get them back. Well, if they stole it from a private person, then it's a different thing. Then that's a special thing. But what we are talking here about is, you know, the abuse of public power for private ends.
So some people But let's just take the scenario, which I think is partly true. I mean, first of all, I'm glad we're agreed that the Philippines can take this action. But if there's a private creditor who hasn't been paid back by the Philippines, And the Marcos family stole the money, why would there be necessarily a problem for you with the creditor taking legal action against the family?
Democracy. The money needs to go back to the Philippines, and it is up for the parliament of the Philippines or whoever is competent to decide how the money should be used. Because otherwise you really give a private creditor power over the money that should not be in the hands of the Marcos, but in the hands of the Philippine Treasury. That is the reason.
I'm not sure that I totally get that, although, you know, let's get some more questions. Yeah.
please.
Hi, Neil Slicker. I have one remark and one question. One thing that I'm always surprised about that I'm hearing today again is people say that Greece didn't have any debt reduction. They had, I think, the biggest debt restructuring since Argentina, which they called PSI. So they did have a lot of debt relief. I appreciate that they didn't have it from the official sector, but that's a separate discussion. Now, my question is, we're talking a lot about all these judgments going against private creditors' claim, but isn't that going the wrong way? You need a sort of a balance, because if the sovereign has all the power, then, you know, lending to a sovereign doesn't make any sense, because they can just decide to repay you or not, which is, in case of Argentina, what happened to quite a lot of these judgments that couldn't be enforced. So aren't we going the wrong way? Shouldn't we have some sort of a balance? And I think you, sir, you spoke about this more, that you could have an institutional framework that actually everybody knows where they stand. Isn't it better to have a sort of a balance than to give all the chips to the sovereigns, which it seems that we're giving it to the ECB? So, you know, I'm going to lose more money because the ECB is a preferred creditor, IMF is a preferred creditor, and maybe Italy or Greece in the next restructuring doesn't even feel like paying me, and they can just get away with it.
Well, I think that you're combining two issues. I mean, one is the issue of discrimination between different classes of creditors, and the other is the question of whether, you know, sovereigns have too much leverage to, you know, to bring about debt restructurings. Now, on the discrimination issue, I have an open mind. I'm not necessarily, I should have said this more explicitly, and I intended to. I don't necessarily agree with the non-discrimination analysis in the ECB case. In other words, I think we have to be very careful about, you know, prioritizing necessarily the IMF or other official institutions. And when we were involved in, Matthias and I in the UNCTAD working group on sovereign debt workouts, you know, I actually was quite opposed the idea that the IMF should necessarily have seniority in terms of repayment. So I'm with you on that. I'm not sure that sovereigns, you know, have so much leverage. I mean, you have to remember why they're restructuring, which is that their economy is in such a bad state that they risk not being able to perform their basic role as a government and their obligations to their own people. So they're usually operating out of a situation of real necessity. And in fact, there is always a certain price that they pay for the restructuring. It's not free. There's empirical evidence that, you know, about the effect of a haircut on how long it takes to get back into the market, and on you know, the terms of new lending to that sovereign. So there is a price that's paid for doing it, which is usually that some delay in full return of access to capital markets, and perhaps more onerous terms. Although one shouldn't exaggerate that either. But basically, what I do agree with in the logic of these decisions that I've read is that we should have essentially a view that there's an implicit term in sovereign debt contracts that they're subject to the sovereign right of the state to restructure if it's faced with a genuine, you know, economic and social crisis. Now, I don't entirely disagree with Matthias that, you know, that probably simply saying there's no jurisdiction to review the reasonableness or the non-discrimination and the equity of a restructuring, I'm not, you know, I don't disagree necessarily that that would be a desirable thing. But if there is a reasonable basis, to use the language of the European Court of Human Rights, and it's non-discriminatory, that, you know, that should be basically understood as a prerogative. I mean, there are lots of ways, you know, there are lots of investments you can make. I don't buy sovereign debt, you know. You don't have to do it, right? If you're an investor. But if you are buying it, you should be buying it subject to the understanding that it's a kind of market that is subject to certain kinds of social, political, economic prerogatives of the borrowing states, and rightly so.
I agree with what you say. The last bit, the problem I have there is if I'm a bank, there's all sorts of regulation that tell me that I have to use government debt for a repo. I have to use it for my liquidity ratios. If I'm a pension fund in the UK, I have specific regulation that tell me I have to buy gilts. There's all sorts of regulation that is enforced upon me that makes me a captive buyer audience. And you have it in lots of countries. So a lot of these investors don't actually have a choice. They have to invest. If you're an asset manager, then of course you have that choice. And the other thing is, as we've seen with the Greek situation, that once you were invested, your regulator wouldn't let you get out. When you owned all these GGBs, the Greek debt, you wanted to sell them, and the regulator told you you were not allowed. And
yeah,
you had
so
to wait
exactly,
for your,
exactly. You know. Very, you know, that's very helpful. It shows that there needs to be a rethinking, because the reason that these, you know, these kinds of regulatory frameworks, you know, for you know, fiduciary investors, investors who are investing on behalf of others, funds, pension funds, and so on, was the sense that, you know, sovereign debt was guaranteed to be repaid. Right? That was the old norm, the old Grundnorm that I think now has been pierced. So now that it's been pierced, you know, the you know, regulators of pension funds and other kinds of, you know, fiduciary investors ought to reconsider, you know, how they treat sovereign debt in the asset mix of these kinds of institutional investors, to reflect the fact that it is risky, and there's a very understandable you know, political risk, which might not exist at least yet for unless Trump is president, for U.S. Treasuries, but still, which in many circumstances, you know, does exist. There's also an economic policy question that I've talked a fair amount with Stiglitz and other economists on, as to, you know, is it a good thing to have easy access to sovereign debt? Some economists say no, that actually sovereign debt is not a good way of addressing the capitalization needs of particularly developing countries, and the best solution would be to wean them off dependency on raising funds in international debt markets and build more robust domestic capital markets, provide the proper incentives for saving and investment in the domestic economy, and so on. And so that's a bigger economic policy, you know, debate about the future of sovereign debt that you know, it's well worth being aware of.
Just very shortly, I was talking about Greece 2015, so the debt restructuring was in 2012, the PSI, and in 2015 we had a debt level which was higher than before the PSI in 2012, and then we had a very dangerous debate about a prohibition, so to say, of the official lenders to restructure Greece debt, which doesn't really, well, I mean, the social background of it was very clearly that the German Treasury didn't want to miss its budgetary goals. It wanted to have a balanced budget. It amounted to a legal argumentation by which they said that you can lend to a Eurozone state through the ESM. That doesn't violate the no bailout clause. But if the risk implicit in that lending materializes, then you would have a violation of 125, which I think doesn't make any sense at all.
Thank you. I have a question to Robert Howse. I was wondering, while listening to you, whether the international practice that you've mentioned could in any way be a legal argument to be used against EU institutions on for the decisions that have been imposing on Greece so far? And I assume that the answer would probably be no, in the absence of a legal framework that Matthias mentioned, and whether that could be possibly one normative reason for in favor of the legal framework.
Well, if we take the situation of Greece, so, you know, as you know, the Greek government came very close to, you know, deciding simply to default and possibly exit the Eurozone, and which would have involved restoring the drachma or some kind of a placeholder a currency, and this was the approach of notoriously of Varoufakis. There was a big internal debate within the Greek government, and a decision to back off, even though there had been a referendum that would have been a democratic support for taking that route. In this process, my advice to the Greek government was to not take the Varoufakis route, even though that had high costs. And the reasons were very specific and had a lot to do with the fact that the Greek banks were not viable at the time. And so my reasoning was that it would be almost impossible, you know, to restart or start again with a new currency and financial system in Greece detached from the Eurozone when you have non-functional banks and people have no confidence in the banks, won't put money in them, won't use them for transactions. So the recapitalization and restructuring of the banking sector, I thought, would be essential. But I don't. I actually think that if the Varoufakis route had been taken, then a lot of this would be tested, right? Because, you know, I mean, I would have said to the Greeks, okay, you're going down that route. Don't concede that you have to leave the Eurozone, default, and then try and get the institutions to force you out. But then that would have left them again with a situation with non-functional banks and considerable uncertainty in the markets about you know whether there were sufficient reserves of euros for the country to prevent a complete and utter breakdown of society. So, you know, and if they go, so in a way, you know, it would have been a good way of standing up to the institutions to say, we're not going to let you kick us out of Europe, we're going to keep the euro, but we're going to default on our obligations. But it would have created so much uncertainty about the viability of the economy in Greek society that it would have been a very high price, you know. I mean, you were dealing with enormously high risk, which Varoufakis was prepared to take in order to make a very big point. I agree with the big point. I didn't necessarily agree with the level of risk taking. So the upshot is that everything now is voluntary. Like, so Greece has agreed to the conditions of the institutions. It's protested them. The government has been honest that that the conditions are punitive in many ways. It's tried to have them mitigated, and I described one way of doing that, which was this independent committee of experts. But in some sense, you know, until Greece basically says no, then we won't really have a test again of whether there's a new Grundnorm. And I believe that if there isn't debt relief, they are likely to say no and possibly go towards default. But my suspicion is that Lou Lagarde and Merkel have basically made a deal, and it won't look like a formal haircut. So, ignorant people in the German countryside can be convinced that Greece is still being punished, but it will be a haircut by any other name involving, you know, certain grace periods, certain interest rate adjustments, certain access to certain ability to borrow concessionally. It will be a package that is everything except a formal haircut. And I think it's interesting that Obama is going to Greece in a couple of weeks, and it's, I don't think, for a vacation. It's because this is something the administration, my sense is, would like settled by the U.S. administration would like settled by the end of the year, just as much as Greece. And the question is, how much of it can be done without humiliating Schäuble? Not that I wouldn't mind for him to be humiliated.
Hi, my name is Laura Galindo, and I have rather a more theoretical question for you both. And I try to understand from which understanding of sovereign debt restructuring do you depart from. And this is because we've seen the title that it says sovereign debt restructuring and international law, as if sovereign debt restructuring is a self-contained system or like. And then from there, my question is, how do you see, through which lenses do you see sovereign debt restructuring? For Professor Robert Howse, shouldn't we read sovereign debt restructuring as a global governance phenomenon? And then for Professor Matthias, when you mention legal review of the sovereign debt restructuring system, or whatever you want to, you will let me know, how would that be so? How can we have some legal review towards the system, and therefore how can we then interpret this principle of sovereign debt sustainability? What should we understand for sustainability? Should be something that we need to define in each case, in each sovereign debt restructuring case? So those are my questions.
I think ultimately the framework, and perhaps this came through a bit by my description of the nature, as I see it, of the dilemma that's posed when a sovereign debt crisis occurs between the state's contractual obligation to repay the lenders and its obligation to its own people and its role as a government to protect them. So it's a human rights-based, or a little broader than that, what Ruti Taitel would call humanity law-based perspective. To my mind, the normative imperative that should be the kind of overall, governing international legal norm should be to prevent a sovereign debt crisis from interfering with a state's ability to fulfill its obligations to its own people for, as the human rights, articulated in the human rights covenants, but also some conception of human security, that the state is responsible for creating an environment of relative stability where people can, lead their lives and be sure that the electricity is not going to be turned off, the water is not going to be turned off, that that there will be some kind of orderliness if there has to be considerable job losses or painful transitions of that nature. So that's the ultimate normative framework for me, the humanity law/human security, human rights framework.
There is a definition of sovereign debt restructuring. It's a very good question. I should have mentioned that. The definition in its core is being used by the IMF. It means basically that your debt is sustainable when you can roll over your debt in the medium term without any major policy changes. That definition is controversial to the extent that it's questionable to what extent, you know, human factors and the situation in the country should play a role in the assessment. So to what extent is, you know, an adequate level of economic and social rights enjoyment really a factor that should matter for that question? So that relates to how you exactly calculate that. And that is somehow controversial, and I think courts can do something about that. Nevertheless, what I would like to emphasize is that sovereign debt restructuring should always be a political negotiating system, and all that courts can do is secure that framework. That means, particularly in a procedural way, secure that everybody was involved, that everybody was heard, that claims were verified, that there was no undue discrimination, that some level of, you know, equality had been maintained. Courts can never say that this policy measure is inadequate per se on an abstract level. They can do that on an individual level, like human rights courts could do that, but it's very difficult for courts to basically make economic and social policy, and I think they should refrain from that and you know, understand it in a more procedural sense.
Thank you. Firstly, yesterday, actually, I googled again the Paris Club for my research, and now it ranks pretty high. The two websites it ranked second, I think.
They've taken care of that.
Yeah, first one being the Wikipedia page of the Paris Club, so I think it's pretty good.
Yeah, that's what you get, the Wikipedia. Then today I did it again, and I got a party space in Stuttgart called the Paris Club.
And now my question is rather about, both speakers mentioned actually the difference between nominal haircuts and reprofiling. And one thing, if we look at the data provided by the Paris Club, we can see that actually the reprofiling also has been evolving over time, from very little in terms of NPV relief to quite large, because with very high and very extended like repayment period or low interest payments. So my question is, from an economic perspective, we do see the difference, I mean, depending on the size of the nominal haircut or how we do reprofiling, for instance, a small haircut versus a profiling over 100 years, actually the economic effects are also different. From the economic perspective, we can see benefits for both forms of debt restructuring. So my question is, from a legal perspective, is there a huge difference of doing either or? So what is the legal cost for the government to take into account?
The devil is in the details in terms of the legal cost. Obviously, there can be some forms of restructuring, which you call reprofiling, that could involve fees. If you stretch out repayment, but you know, charge interest, the additional time, then that, you know, but there are ways of stretching out repayment that basically also forgive the interest for an extremely long period of time, and that may be part of the solution with respect to, you know, to Greece. The advantage of nominal haircuts is they actually price the debt to market in a way that reprofiling, you know, doesn't really do. If you price the debt to market, then you enable an efficiently functioning, a secondary market, because you have a real price that reflects, you know, the risk of the debt. So there's something economically, I think, preferable to the nominal haircuts rather than this, you know, disguised approach. And it may also be a way of, I think it gives also investors more confidence that they know, you know, what they're dealing with, that the ultimate debt burden of the country is something they can calculate in determining the level of risk, whereas the, you know, these other more disguised methods don't produce those kinds of signals that can be very helpful. I mean, Argentina did very well economically after the nominal haircut. But the bottom line is Greece will never repay this money. It will either not repay it by defaulting if debt relief isn't coming, but there's no way they can repay it. Everybody knows that, except the domestic audience of Schäuble, who are being misled that somehow if you punish the country enough, it's going to pay back this money. It's just not a reality. So the question is, what is going to happen? And you know, if you basically say, okay, it doesn't have to be repaid till Schäuble is in the eighth circle of hell, then that solves the problem at one level. It gives the Greek public finances relief, but it doesn't produce the market efficiency that would be produced by allowing the debt to be restructured to reflect the actual market value.
Apart from the economic differences, there's a regulatory issue here. So if you have a haircut instead of a rescheduling only, that means that banks, if we're talking about private creditors, that banks need to write that off. If you just have a rescheduling, you will have some material losses, you will have lower income in returns in the future. Nevertheless, you don't need to write it off, so your capital doesn't get depleted. And that is sometimes very important. It's one of the reasons why in the 1980s there was so little debt relief, or basically no debt relief.
That's an extremely good point. And again, it's what would be economically efficient would be to make the banks write it off, because yep. you would then be actually telling the market the truth about the assets versus liabilities, the real assets versus liabilities of that financial institution. But it's obvious that they don't like it.
They want to muddle through. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But in the case that the creditors are government and these public sector restructurings, these regulatory aspects is not there.
No. And so that's not what's really driving this in the Greek case. It's something else, the politics in Germany.
Yes, I have two questions, very short. The first one is for Professor Howse. The cases you have mentioned, even though Postova frames the idea of that sovereign debt is excluded from investment generally, they concern negotiating sovereign debt restructuring. Would you extend that idea that also unilateral debt restructuring should be excluded from the concept of investment? And the second one goes to Dr. Goldmann. In CETA, they make an idea that there is, Professor Howse, that there is a carve-out for sovereign debt, but it is only for negotiated sovereign debt when it meets certain requirements. So ISDS would not have jurisdiction for negotiated sovereign debt. Would you think that idea that only under certain circumstances a jurisdiction is not going to apply a good solution for what you're saying, that you need a rule of law there? Thank you very much.
Well, so there's a compromise embedded in this language about negotiated restructuring. In a way, it's not hard for a state to procure a negotiated restructuring by threatening creditors that that if they don't agree to a negotiated restructuring, they'll end up with less or nothing. So I don't think it's a very big compromise. It seems to me normally what you're going to have in these situations, and it may depend also on the kind of collective action clauses in the debt contracts, is that you're going to get a negotiated restructuring, but then you're going to get people who are holdouts or buy from holdouts who are vultures and you know, and so on. And the reason you'll get the negotiated restructuring, as I say, is that the sovereign can, you know, can make enough credible threats, you know, to get that, to get a negotiated solution, simply by saying that if you negotiate with us, you'll get a better deal than if you turn your back on us and we simply decide we're not going to pay you anything, or maybe, you know, pay you in 15 years' time. So I'm not so worried about the situation where there's no negotiated restructuring. That's my basic answer.
On jurisdictions, I think that's a very good question. Why should CETA or should the ISDS under CETA be responsible or not? I think I can understand the solution, because the problem that we have with all these courts is that there are so many of them. Look at Argentina, a whole fragment. There's a lot of forum shopping going on. Look at Greece, how many cases we've had in so many different courts. You've got national attacks, you've got cases in other member states that sometimes make it to the ECJ, sometimes not. You've got the European Court of Human Rights, you've got a dispute settlement. So and that is the problem. If we lived in an ideal world, I think there would be just one court competent for it. And maybe that's something that you can also agree upon contractually or through an FAA.
Just as long as it's not the Second Circuit.
yeah. But if it's a court like the one, you know, down the road here, I wouldn't be worried to have one competent court for that and one trustworthy court. So there is a problem with fragmentation, and the question is really, what is the lesser evil? No jurisdiction at all, so states do what they want, or a completely fragmented landscape of jurisdictions. And if states say in that situation, well, you know, let's rather exclude it, if it's really been a negotiated settlement, I think it's a reasonable way to go about.
Here we want to take advantage of our lecturers, but not to exhaust them. And they have been speaking for 2 hours. So I don't mean that they have to stop speaking, but invite and everyone to join for a drink outside, where we could go on with more informal talks. But before all, I would like to thank very much our lecturers. It promised to be lively. It has been. And so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And because it was great, like the previous conference, I'm happy to tell you that you can have a replay on the internet, because we have podcasted the lectures. And the first one from 2 weeks ago is available on our website and our YouTube channel. And then this one will be available very soon also, once it had been framed. So thank you very much again. And please take the time to have a drink with us just outside the room in the foyer. Thank you very much.